virtually. For virtual meetings, committee members will be muted until asked to be heard. At that time, they will be recognized and will be unmuted. When there is a vote, it will be necessary to take a roll call vote. A committee member will be recognized and will raise their hand and state their vote. Today's meeting is a public meeting. The meeting also will be live streamed on the city's YouTube channel, which can be accessed at www.cityofws.org/2682/video. A recording of today's meeting will be available Tuesday, July 28th on the city's website.
The chair recognizes Mayor Jones to give the welcome.
Thank you, Chairman Bailey. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, let me just say thank you for your willingness to serve on this committee. It came together fairly quickly after the City Council did approve the transfer of $1 million into this fund. And by the way, let me acknowledge my colleague, Councilmember Scipio, who is on the call. And I don't know if there are other council members on the call as well. I don't see them, but if you are, let me know. But the council and I, I'm sorry?
Jeff
McIntosh. Okay, great. Thank you, Jeffrey McIntosh. The council and I certainly felt like it's very appropriate that we take some demonstrative steps and actions in regard to some of the social unrest that were involved in our city. And I think it shows a clear understanding and a clear commitment by the city of Winston-Salem to address concerns. We've been very, very fortunate, and I'm so proud of our city of Winston-Salem that the social unrest, the protests, demonstrations were all very, very peaceful. No damage, no injuries in our community. And I think that speaks a lot to the fact that we as a community have worked in advance to establish relationships between the city and the neighborhoods, between the police department and the neighborhoods, and between individuals and other and individual leaders within the community. So I think that speaks very well of our city. That being said, it's a big task in front of the committee. I appreciate your willingness to roll your sleeves up and work on this. It will be one that will be a lot of public review, a lot of scrutiny, and looking at your decisions. I know you'll do a great job in reviewing the proposals that will come before you and potential funding that will come before you. Again, I thank Claudette Bailey for her willingness to serve as chairman and Mr. Pettigrew for the willingness to serve as vice chairman, and to each one of the committee members for your willingness to participate in this very, very important work. So again, I wish you well, and I look forward to seeing the results of your work. Thank you very much.
The chair asks Patrice Tony to read the charge of the commitment.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Mayor, for your remarks. At the adoption of the FY21 budget, Councilmember Taylor and Councilmember Betsy presented a resolution in response to the hardship and record number of unemployment rates from the impact of COVID-19 pandemic and nationwide protests against racial injustice. According to the resolution, the city is holding action on plans and needed community investment and the city and city employee compensation due to high uncertainty in revenue projections and overall economic conditions. Therefore, the Community Investments Review Committee was unanimously voted on and given the charge to make recommendations for city investments of up to $1 million total expenditures to address conditions which contribute to poverty and hardship in our community. Recommendations of the committee shall be completed by October the 1st of 2020 and shall be considered or approved by the mayor and city council in part or in whole. And that's the end of the charge. If anyone has any questions, please let me know. Chairman Bailey?
President of Pecan Ridge Homeowners Association Neighborhood Watch, I reside in the East Ward. Next, we will have Kenneth Pettigrew, Vice Chair.
Good afternoon, everyone. And again, we thank you for your commitment to serve. I'm honored to be serving as your Vice Chair during this time. My name is Kenneth Pettigrew. I am a resident of the North Ward, and I live in the Boston Thurman neighborhood. I am currently serving as the Chief Operating Officer of the Winston-Salem Urban League and on the ministerial staff at the St. John CME Church here in Winston, also located in Boston Thurman. And I am happy to share this time with you.
We will have members from the North Ward to introduce themselves.
Kenneth Pettigrew is from the North Ward, and the other person from the North Ward is not able to attend today's meeting.
All right, thank you. Northwest Ward.
My name is Christy Robinson. I'm from the Northwest Ward. I'm a mother of three, two in elementary school, one in preschool, and I'm the co-founder of an organization called Women of Action.
I'm Greg Beyer. I'm from the Northwest Ward. I'm retired from Forsyth Medical Center, and I'm on the Habitat for Humanity Board as well.
Thank you. The Northeast Ward. The Northeast Ward. The South Ward.
Hello, I'm Joshua Canzone. I'm having some audio trouble, but you might be able to hear me over the phone. I work at Wake Forest University School of Divinity and also at School of the Arts.
Southeast Ward.
Joshua.
Southeast Ward. Southwest Ward. The West Ward.
Good afternoon. My name is Debbie Hunter. I am a healthcare consultant with Press Ganey Associates.
And I am Rainey Pitt. I am a member of the West Ward as well. I'm a lawyer here in Winston-Salem, and I'm a former chair of our housing authority.
Thank you. The East Ward.
Hi, this is London McKinney. I am the current precinct chair for the 14th Street precinct, and I reside in the East Ward.
Are there any wards that I missed?
Hi.
At large.
My name is Francis Pimentel, and I live in the Southwest West Ward.
Thank you. At large members.
Let me just make a statement. If you're not speaking, please put your phone on mute. There's a lot of background noise. And I just want to say, I know for sure there's the two people from the Northeast Ward are on the call. So if you want to introduce yourselves as well.
Thank you.
Sam Pinkerson?
Mm-hmm.
Large members. Do we have any at-large members on the call? Purpose and timeline. All meetings will be held at 2:00. Dates starting with July 30th, 2020, August 13, 2020, August 27th, 2020, September 10th, 2020, September 24th, finalization for recommendations. At this time, we'll have Vice Chair Kenneth for the CIRC planning process.
All right, good afternoon again, everyone. I hope you can hear me fine. So I want to share a few thoughts about our planning process for the work that we're going to do together in order to make our recommendations to City Council come October. To begin, the planning process will begin by generating ideas on programs, services, or investments that address poverty and issues of social justice. Patrice Tony, who is the budget director, will share some existing city investments and anti-poverty recommendations made by the Poverty Thought Force as a basis for beginning to think about ideas. Then you, us together, these committee members will work with the other committee member from our ward or another at-large representative and to decide on some ideas that you would like to present at one of the future meetings. Our goal is to have one presenter from each ward for a total of 9 presentations around ideas. Ideas will then be submitted to Patrice Tony on a form so that city staff can organize the ideas and provide budgeting and cost information if we need them. The full committee will then vote on their top program ideas, and then there will be a major marketing campaign to engage residents in voting or weighing in on the suggested projects. A final tally and vote will be made by the committee, and the recommendations will be submitted to the mayor and city council. So I would like for us to consider these things along in our planning process, and for us to, at this moment and as we go forward in our work, to really begin considering what the ideas that we may have individually, what ideas have popped up in our local communities and those that we are around on a regular basis, but additionally to think big picture about what it means to address the issue of poverty and to address the issue of social justice and equity within our city. And that may mean larger investments that don't necessarily go into programs, or it may mean investments that definitely do go into programs. What we do on this committee will determine how those investments are made. So we must think fully, we must think big, and we must think about our local communities as well. And so at this time, I would like to invite Patrice to review some examples of our city's existing anti-poverty investments.
Thank you, Vice Chair Hattie Grew. Right before I do that, I know we were having audio trouble, and we apologize. I just want to acknowledge some other people that I know that are on the call, that members of the committee, and just really quick, so if you didn't hear them, it's Kanika Brown. She's representing the Southeast Ward. Sam Hickerson, he's representing the Northeast Ward, and he's going to replace Philip, who is on your list, and I'll send an update. Frankie Gist is on the call. He is an at-large member. Dr. Melissa Witt Glover, she's representing the South Ward. Gracia Santillan, she's representing the Northeast Ward. So if there's others that I missed, we apologize. I think we heard from most of the others. I think London McKinney's also, I believe, on the call from the East Ward. Okay. So now I'm going to share my screen with you to show some examples of the city, current city investment. The purpose of showing you this is to give you all a basis to begin your planning, some of your ideas. Obviously, the ideas can be new. The ideas can complement some existing city services. You can also utilize the Poverty Thought Force as a basis of your ideas and recommendations. So I'll quickly just go through this list so you're kind of aware of some of the programs and services the city already invests in related to anti-poverty and social justice issues. So the first one is the reintegration and youth development. This is also referred to as the SOAR program, which stands for Successful Outcomes After Release. There's a work program component that employs 8 people who are reintegrating into society, and they are placed in various city departments across the city and are paid at the minimum rate of pay of $13 per hour. Also, there are 8 young people ages 18 through 24 who are in the construction training program. So this investment includes 3 full-time positions that support both of the programs. The city also has a MWBE program, which assists minority and women-owned business enterprises in providing goods and services to the city. There's a business development program where this provides technical and financial assistance to both small business owners and commercial property owners. We also have a human relations department. That department has a fair housing program, which handles landlord and tenant resolutions and disputes for fair housing complaints and various issues around fair housing. They also have a building integrated communities program, which supports immigrant communities. They also do youth development. They do trust talks and sponsor ADA disability rights programming. The next 2 items on the list are connected to economic development bonds. One was passed in 2014, one was passed in 2018. Both of these provide business improvements through grants and loans in targeted areas to help declining urban commercial areas in our community. You'll see SOAR again. This particular part of SOAR is for our grant. So we fund nine community agencies right now that support local former offenders, kind of reintegrate back into the community. And so the nonprofit support that effort, or they help with at-risk youth to prevent any future issues. We also support a summer youth employment program. That program is administered by the Winston-Salem Urban League. It employs 112 low to moderate income youth ages 15 to 19 at participating host sites across the city. We fund and support homeless reduction. We do that through an annual grant to the Bethesda Center each year. We also support domestic violence services. That is done through a grant that supports the DA's Office Domestic Violence Unit. Veteran Services, and that funds two community agencies run community agency process, that Perry's Vets and NAM Vets. They support veterans, and that their help helps to reduce poverty, homelessness, and increase economic mobility for our veterans. We also fund a drug treatment court. We support the drug treatment court. That funding is through Phoenix Rising, and they provide case management and treatment of drug abuse, and that helps reduce recidivism rates. Support to seniors, that is through our community agency process, and that goes to the Shepherd Center, and they are able to keep seniors in their homes longer by providing transportation and minor home repairs and respite care for family members. The Institute for Dismantling Racism, that funding supports that agency to host trainings and workshops that help participants understand systemic and systematic racism, and that is through our community agency process. We also support the promotion of underserved entrepreneurs. That's done through a grant to Venture Cafe. They have a program that serves underserved entrepreneurs. They support innovation and economic mobility, and they particularly focus on women and people of color. We fund the or support the Work Family Resource Center that gives out information about local child care. This next one is the Choice Neighborhood Program. This is a major grant that our community development department applied for and received. They received $30 million. That will be a local investment in partnership with the Housing Authority to replace 244 existing apartments in Cleveland Avenue homes, and then they're going to build 406 new units. The nice thing is that the grant also includes funds for education, workforce development, small business assistance, neighborhood revitalization, and other programs in order to improve the lives of residents. Housing Finance Fund, those are local dollars that are designated for affordable housing and community development. Over 10 years, we've invested over $15 million. The Home Investment Partnership and the Community Development Block Grant are federal grants, and those dollars are used locally for affordable housing and community development programs. For our Emergency Solution Grant, this is also federal dollars that prioritize the needs of homelessness that are identified in the community's continuum of care strategy. So over 10 years, that's been a $22.7 million investment. The next two are housing development from general obligation bonds. These are all related to supporting affordable housing. You can see a list of some of the projects that these two housing bonds have supported over the years. Think Orange. This is a campaign that was initially funded from the National League of Cities. That money is to address food insecurity in the local community. True Lion has also supported this endeavor by contributing $25,000. We have a bus match distribution program. This program provides aid to nonprofit organizations in distributing food bus passes to low-income populations. We also have an urban food council. That's the citizen committee that promotes the actions to increase food access to residents in our city. The pilot was to fund the startup of an urban farmers market and to address community food strategies. You all are probably familiar with the COVID-19 response fund that was initiated by our mayor. It was a partnership with the Winston-Salem Foundation and the United Way of Forsyth County, and this was to support residents who suffering from the economic fallout of the COVID-19 pandemic. The city pledged $1 million. I think the overall fund raised over $3 million to the local community, and the money has gone to nonprofits to help people in need. And then finally, there is we have a partnership for prosperity. Annually, we contribute $40,000 to that. This grew out of the Winston-Salem Poverty Thought Force convened by our mayor, Mayor Jones. The Thought Force developed 56 recommendations to alleviate poverty, and one of the ideas of that came out of the to develop the Partnership for Prosperity. I've also sent you a link to the Poverty Thought Force recommendations. As I mentioned before, those recommendations are really great and well thought through by a committee, and so that will also give you some ideas to think about as you are developing your recommendations. So I will send this list out to you so you can have in your possession and some of the recommendations from the Poverty Thought Force that you can have to begin deliberating. And with that, Madam Chairperson, I am complete with my report.
Thank you. Initial committee thoughts and ideas. The chair asked the committee for any initial thoughts about the process of ideas, and we will limit this to 3 people. Any thoughts? I'm not hearing.
Hi, my name is Christy Robinson. I have one idea. With school being virtual for the first 9 weeks, I think it would be helpful for the community and the Winston-Salem County Schools to provide some sort of child care for children both school-aged and before school-aged, so parents can continue working and providing food and housing for their children and their families, but also have a safe place for children to go and learn. And I wonder if some of these dollars could be distributed to tutors or community centers that could provide child care or tutoring programs during this time.
Thank you for your comment.
Madam Chair, this is Rennie Pitt. I think what Christy is talking about is something that is dear to me as well, and that is how can we enhance the education experience for those who are less fortunate than a lot of us. And it would seem to me that maybe some of these monies could be utilized maybe in conjunction with the school system to make sure that appropriate technology is available to the students who obviously will be with remote training all. So that was a thought that I had that sort of expands on a little bit of what Christy said.
Thank you for your comment.
And Madam Chair, Rennie Pitt again. One point that, and this is a question as much as anything else. So many of those poverty programs that we currently fund, the money seems to be funded through organizations, nonprofit organizations. Are we intending to benefit individuals to the extent we can identify them, maybe through those organizations, so as to minimize a lot of the administrative costs and maximize the benefit to deserving individuals? And I just don't know if that's part of our charge or not. I raise that as a question only.
This is London McKinney. That's a great question, because I too have concerns about some of the programs that are listed and how successful they have been in the past.
So this is Kenneth. I will add to some of the comments that Mr. Pitt has made and some things that Ms. McKinney has shared, and say that I believe that the work of this committee allows us to look at this investment and the use of these dollars in creative ways, possibly outside of them being invested in the work of agencies or organizations that that do work in the community. I think some of what we will have to determine for ourselves is philosophy, because what anti-poverty work means to me may be very different than what anti-poverty work means to some of you who are on this committee. And so our philosophical understanding of what anti-poverty work and what investing in issues of social justice means will be something that we will have to discuss. And some of that also comes because in recognizing that we might be investing in social justice work, the real question is whether or not we will be investing in things that are designed to promote equity amongst the citizens of our community, recognizing that there are real divides in our community, both in terms of access to resources, what it means to have generational wealth and generational resources, and what the long-term reality of what these investments can mean for us in general. And so I think the questions and the suggestions that have already been made and posed fit well within the broader conversation we may have to have about what do we want these dollars to accomplish just as much as where they go.
Thank you, Vice Chair. And now we will have the committee assignments by Kenneth, the Vice Chair.
Yes, so we decided that because our timeline is so very tight, and we do have to begin making decisions sooner rather than later in order to make our recommendations to mayor and council in time, that we're going to have to do a little homework between our meetings. And I know that we're all, of course, not busy enough. but we're going to have to do a little homework between our meetings. And so what Chair Bailey and I, along with city staff, are asking each member of the committee to do is to review the information that Patrice is going to share with you on the city's investments, some of that she shared during the meeting today, along with the Poverty Thought Force report that was shared prior to this meeting. And so we're asking you to begin thinking about ideas, possibly for programs or other creative ways of investment that address poverty and social justice issues. Keeping in mind, of course, that the recommendations could include adding resources to existing programs or creating new things. So I do want that to be very clear, that the recommendations could be about adding resources to things that are working or that we feel need to be expanded or creating new things. I'm putting emphasis in particular on the creating new things. And so what we're asking that we hinted at earlier is for you to reach out to the other committee member in your ward. If they are not here today, please reach out. Introduce yourself, you're going to receive a new contact list, to have a discussion, to share ideas, and then, of course, to decide the all-important piece of who's going to be the spokesperson during our meeting when we begin sharing ideas and having discussion around what ideas can be, and you are very welcome to alternate for different meetings. So in short, begin thinking, begin brainstorming, talking with your fellow committee member from your ward, preparing even with an at-large member of the committee, and you can even begin together crowdsourcing ideas from the communities where you reside so that we can have a good place to start and a foundational place to begin our work. So, yes, everyone, please do your homework. The teachers will be checking it when we come back together.
Thank you, Kenneth. The next meeting will be Thursday, July 30th, 2020, at 2 p.m. via WebEx. If there is no other business, this meeting is hereby adjourned. And I look forward to meeting with you again on July 30th. Have a great day and remain safe.
I'm sorry, Chairwoman Bailey?
Yes.
Hey, Councilwoman Scipio has posted a question in the chat.
Yes.
Councilwoman posted a question in the chat, and she wants to know what are the social justice issues that should be targeted.
Well, as Ken said, we all gonna get together with each other and work together, and we'll kind of work all this thing out. Today is the first day, and like he says, we are going to do our homework, and we will all come together and work together and figure out what everything is.
And I just want to echo that, and I agree with that, Chairperson. Yes, the only charge is to come up with some ideas related to social justice or anti-poverty initiatives. So we're open to whatever recommendations the committee sees fit to recommend. I also just wanted to just apologize for our technical difficulty on the call today. I know it says WebEx meeting for the following meeting, but what we'll do after this call is I'll get with city staff and we'll work on a Zoom option that may be a little bit easier for everyone to get in, and hopefully we won't have these audio and video issues going forward. So we will update you, and I'll send out the necessary information for you to get started.
Thank you.
Do you want to officially adjourn again?
That's what I was just wondering. Okay. The meeting is now adjourned. Have a great day and remain safe.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you all.